You're listening to Getting Things Done, the official podcast of the David Allen Company, with our feature presentation from David Allen on the power of the weekly review. Welcome everyone to Getting Things Done, GTD for shorthand. My name is Andrew J. Mason, and this podcast is all about helping you on your journey practicing the art of stress-free productivity. Today, we are so excited to offer you a rare glimpse at a presentation David's done on the power of the weekly review. In this talk, David shares his thoughts on what a good review is and isn't, as well as some random tips and tricks he's learned from his years in the trenches. This episode is meant to pair well with Episode 7, A Guided Weekly Review. If you find yourself hungry for more and would like to actually have a sense of what a guided review might be like, check that episode out. Like always, this content is just a preview of the type of content you can find regularly on GTD Connect and our online store, and you can get to both of those destinations by heading to gettingthingsdone.com. And now, from the archives, here's David on the power of the weekly review.
Let's assume you got everything out of your head. Let's assume you've processed it all discreetly, actions, projects, reference, etc. Let's assume you've got it nice and organized. This still will die a slow, sure death if you don't keep it alive and current. So the fourth stage we're going to look at in the workflow is the review process. How do I keep this stuff going? People have asked me, they say, David, over 500,000 people have been through some of your education over the last 20 years. Who sticks with this and who doesn't? Got a simple answer. Anybody who's doing some version of a weekly review has stuck with it, it's lived and grown. People who don't, it's died. That's it. Because this stuff is only as good as it is current, otherwise your brain has to become your system again. So if your system's out of date, then it's too much trouble to keep up the system. So this, you can fall off slowly, slowly, then you'll crash. Because as soon as this gets too far behind, you'll know that the system is not really your system, your brain still has to be your system anyway. So the system is extra work. It's not worth doing because it's not giving you payoff of relieving the brain of that pressure. So you have to, just like any relationship, folks, you gotta invest in it. It does not self-maintain. And the same is true with your personal systems. They don't self-maintain. You've got to keep going back to them. Now, not every second, every minute are you going to sit down and keep that organized. Life comes at you and me both a lot faster than we can keep it pristinely processed and organized. But you don't want to go too long. And certainly you need to have collected triggers for everything as it's come in. That you can't skimp on. That's why I spent so much time on collect, because if you let that stuff slip, you're dead, because there's no way to go retrieve that stuff unless you get back in and try to grapple with it. But at least as long as you have some trigger for the thing, then as long as you come back, and we've found 7 days to be the critical cycle for this, that once every 7 days, it really seems to be the critical piece, you know, around that. So maybe a little bit more, a little less, but at least every so often, you need to come back and look at things from the project viewpoint, not just from the action viewpoint. And I think that's why 7 days is so critical, because 7 days seems to be about, if you looked at all of your projects, by my definition of projects, closely every 7 days, that's probably all you need to look at those. But you do need to look at them that often. That's not all that you're doing about those projects. It's, I mean, that's how often you're sitting down and catching up, called, do I have all the actions current on that project and on that project and on that project? Now again, if you get a project on Monday that's due on Thursday, you better not wait till a Friday weekly review to review it. You're dead. You know, you better review that project 3 times a day until it's done. But generally speaking, you know, this 7-day process of sitting down and going through your list, going through your stuff, catching up, is really critical. Now we've given you a list there of the blow-by-blow, and I'm not going to go through all the details of that because it's written there. But that is not some theoretical thing we just, you know, thought might be a good idea. That is literally what you would see me do yesterday. When I flew back from Orlando, that is exactly what you saw me doing, if you sat on the plane right next to me, in that order. And the bottom line of this is you need to gather and process your stuff. Actually, gathering and processing your stuff is so that you can start your weekly review. Now, a lot of people think they're doing a weekly review because they actually blocked out a couple of hours and cleaned up their email. No, that got you ready for the weekly review. I actually got an email from a guy not long ago. He said, David, one of the things I've learned to do is I've now got a Thursday weekly review before my Friday weekly review. Because the Thursday weekly review is when I go and clean up all the email and clean up all the stuff and get close to zero. So when I actually sit down on Friday to do a weekly review, it's up at the weekly review level, not just cleanup. That's getting ready to it, is where you just get all the stuff clean. Then what you're doing is you're reviewing your system. And this is what I do. Basically, I'm reviewing my system, I'm pulling it out, and I'm going through my list. The first thing I do, by the way, is I go through my list and mark off done things. Many times I'm moving so fast, I don't even have time to mark done stuff. I've had some weekly reviews where I sat down and it took me about 20 minutes to find all the things I'd actually finished that were on the list I hadn't even had time to mark off as done, much less figure out what's next. I'm on a roll. You know, so I need to back off and come back and go, oh, okay. And so before I start adding anything to list, I need to make sure I don't need to take anything off the list. You understand? I want to get it clean first. So the first thing I'm doing before I'm adding anything to these is I'm going through and marking off any of the actions that have been finished, and then I go mark off any projects that have been finished. The next thing I do is I look back 2 weeks on my calendar. I go back in detail and go through the last 2 weeks. I'll bet every one of you in this room right now, if you pulled out your calendar and looked in detail on your calendar for the last 2 weeks, every one of you is going to find at least one, if not several, oh, that reminds me I need to. Sometimes some fairly critical stuff, too. So part of the weekly review is to help catch some of those things that have been flying around. Because if you live in the kind of world I do, this stuff comes at and around us so fast. I mean, you're on 15 different phone calls and stuff have moved out and it's coming at you and you met somebody at the hall and then you had lunch with this new person and I like that. I mean, I happen to like that kind of, fast activity. And not as a stressful thing, but just as input, change, you know, new stuff, new opportunities. I think that's neat. But because it flies at me, oftentimes some of that stuff I missed. Oh, yeah, there's something I'd like to do about that now. Or, yeah, I told him I'd get back to him and I didn't catch that one. So it's subtle stuff. So just sometimes going back and looking at your calendar, that's why sometimes it's not a bad idea to get in the habit of sometimes adding stuff to your calendar after you've done it if it wasn't on your calendar. Just because when you do the weekly review, it's kind of nice to do a little bit of a post-mortem on some of the details that may have shown up there. And then, by the way, what I'm doing is looking at my calendar for the next... Guess how far I look ahead in my calendar in the weekly review? As far as there's anything on it. As far as there is anything on it. Every week. Now, you know, once I get out past like next 6 months or 8 months, yeah, I can look at the month at a glance on the calendar just with click, 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 because there's not that much on it. So it doesn't really take that much time. But I'm doing that because, you know, especially in my game out there these days, there's a lot of upgrades to international flights you can't get unless you get them about 6 months ahead. You know, this is like just critical for my lifestyle. You know, I've learned some of those kinds of things. I see trips coming toward me out way in the future. I need to start doing a little bit of planning about some of these things. And it just helps tee up my brain because actually it's a visualization process because I'm visualizing success of all these things as I see them on my calendar. So it's a great little tool, just a precursor of any of that. So looking out, I'll bet every one of you right now, if you pulled out your calendar right now and looked at the next 2, 3, 4, 5 weeks in detail, every one of you is going to go, oh, that reminds me, I need to. And as things get closer to you on calendar, sometimes that triggers actions that don't while they're farther away. So again, it's just not, that's a great way to just update. That's what review my system looks like, right? Then when I do that, then updating my list. And that may come from cleaning up emails. That may come from now, wow, here's 4 new projects that started that actually I haven't had time to even define as a project, but now are. Now I'm going back and adding stuff to these lists. Many times I get on constructive rabbit trails, especially if I'm on a long cross-country plane trip where I have time to take this review out into 2-3 hours. I'll let myself run down rabbit trails, and I go down that project and capture ideas and add some more project thinking and then come back and then keep doing the review and then generate some more ideas. And wow, that reminds me about this. And you know, I'm doing all and sending emails while I'm thinking about that. So a lot of times it's a very constructive time for me. I'm not constricted. That's why I have the luxury of long plane trips regularly. It's a perfect time for me to do that kind of work. You know, there's enough stimulus and interruption to keep me engaged, but, you know, not too much that it keeps me from being able to do that kind of thinking, you know, over an extended period. So then I'm updating my list, and, you know, basically it's just getting clean, clear, current, complete again. Come on, you all got a reference point for this. You know when I've discovered most people feel best about their job? A week before your vacation. But it's not about your vacation. Come on, what are you folks doing a week before your vacation? You're doing all this. I just suggest you just do this weekly, not yearly. So you know the reference point. A lot of you had to do a mini version of this just to come to this seminar because you had to block out time to be able to do this. So you had to look at all your stuff and renegotiate with yourself and other people. And that's really where the freedom comes from and the in-control feeling comes from. It doesn't come from having a vacation. It comes from getting ready for it. You folks understand? So just make your life one getting ready for vacation. Then you're on vacation all the time. It's challenging, though. It's challenging because you need to spend quality time detached from the daily grind, but thinking about getting control of and managing the daily grind. So it's like, how do you manage the grind if you're in it? And if you leave it, you don't want to think about it. So that's why this is challenging, is you have to back off enough from the interrupt-driven, yank your chain, pick up the phone stuff to then get control of all that stuff before you get away from it. The problem is most people get ground up in the daily grind and then leave and then hate Mondays. So the trick is to somehow back off and do, you know, forest management instead of tree hugging. You know, and this is not stare at your navel, walk around the rose garden, figure out what you're doing with your life stuff. You know, this is dealing with your 65 projects and putting them in front of your face one at a time. What is it? Oh, that reminds me. Oh, yeah. And you're, you know, getting down to this operational nitty gritty, but not as nitty gritty as your work. So it's that stage. And that's why, again, the project list is the most rare list to find. The weekly review is the most rare behavior to find because it's driven off the project list. But if you want the key to stress-free productivity, here it is. Keep a project list current, and once a week, keep it up. And all the attendant actions there, too. In a sense, it's that simple. But I think most people haven't found the need for that, or otherwise you'd be doing it. But once you get used to what I'm talking about in terms of stress-free productivity, you'll have to do this, just have to do it. Now, people have often asked, what's the best time to do the weekly review? I would recommend if you do a typical kind of work week, like Monday through Friday, then you take off for a weekend, good time to do that is early Friday afternoon. I would recommend at the end of the week instead of at the beginning of the week. I mean, any time is fine. You'll be ahead of the planet if you do it any time. But the best, most ideal time is before the week gets too old. Because there's a lot of things that if you go too long, your brain will dump context. It's hard to remember what went on in that meeting past about 7 days. So if you can do a post-mortem on your week before you leave it on Friday afternoon, that's really great. And early Friday afternoon is a great time to do it, too. Because first of all, you can't be toast in your head when you do this. You know, you can't have, you know, your horsepower all used up by 8 o'clock on Friday night and try to do this review. It needs more creative energy than that. And many times you start your review, if you can start it early enough on Friday, many of the two-minute things that will surface while you're doing that, you can actually handle if you can still reach people at their desk and office. And you can get a lot of closure on stuff as you're doing your review as long as there's still work going on. So ideally, maybe, if you leave work by 5, you know, like you start at 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock kind of a review and build time to do that. Now, if you haven't, it's a little easier if you haven't the luxury of an office with a door you can close. I have a number of executives that have set up protocols for themselves to just Friday, they just make an appointment for 11 to 1 with themselves. And they call out for a sandwich and close their door. And that's when they catch up. And I know one guy, actually a guy in Westlake has a business there, and he does his weekly review Saturday morning because he likes to take off on Friday and just play golf. And then he just comes into the office on Saturday morning. The world is slowed down. It's a great place. He knows he needs to do that. And that's what works for him. So again, that's the ideal thing. So if you can close the door, it makes it a little bit easier to hold the world back. And everybody salutes, because they know, God, this is such a rare time to be able to get, to hold the world back, to be able to process, to do that. I met one manager that their weekly staff meeting starts with 30 minutes of quiet time, everybody in that room doing their own review and catch up, at least 30 minutes worth. I think that's great if somebody can support that. They know the strategic value of having the folks sort of get a little handle on their stuff, you know, before they start out there in the week, you know, start cranking away at this stuff. But whatever you can do was great. It's nice if you have typical, you know, if you can build habits about this, go same place to sit down, same thing to do. So make sure your workstation is attractive to you. It's one of the best things you can do. Make sure, and that's at home and at work, if those are two different places. Make it attractive. Well, one of the best things to do is look around. I know, so just ask yourself, if you're feeling like, you know, I'm not yet attracted to that work environment, that'll make all this stuff a whole lot easier, and especially the weekly review. Now, that's where you sit down, you're queen of the hill, king of the hill, and you're just in control. That's why at home, you must have your own space. You know, don't try to share this with significant others. That'll create some of the most frustration in the world. You know, you need your own in-basket, they need theirs, you need your own workspace. And if you have the same desk, at least have one half theirs, one half yours. You know, truly, you must have your own thing that you're in control of in terms of space that way. So that'll make all this stuff a little bit easier. So I wish I could give you a magic pill that would get you to do the weekly review. The folks who've been in this seminar and worked with this material before, every one of them in this room, I guarantee you, this is the challenge, is to get yourself to keep it up. The first hurdle is to just get in, is to go set up the system to begin with, and the second one is to keep it alive. So that's what I would recommend that you do and build that in. That weekly review is something you might want to copy. You might want to customize your own version of that. I have my own version of weekly review myself because there's some things I add into mine. Every one of you has unique things to your life that you probably want to be reminded of once a week. I do too. So the questions would be, and let me take questions just about the weekly review now, too, if you have that. So the question is, where would I put my weekly review checklist if I wanted to see that? Well, here's a pop quiz, okay? Where would you put, what is the answer to that question? Well, the way I would do it, because I have this system set up, is the tickler file. If you had a tickler file, what you do is just put, you don't have, need to rewrite that at all, just drop that in next Friday. And then it'll pop into your in-basket, then walk yourself through review, take the checklist, drop it next Friday. That's another great way to use a tickler file, is for those kinds of things. In that same vein, a little sidebar on that, how many of you ever read stuff that's inspirational or funny and you want to get more mileage out of it? Any of you ever get those? Yeah. I guarantee you the way to absolutely go numb and get zero more mileage out of it is put it in front of your face. Because you go numb to it. Because you can't maintain that humor and that inspiration, so because you're not maintaining it, you're looking at it uninspired, and so the inspiration drops off of that tool, that trigger. So one of the best ways to go numb is put things on bulletin boards in front of you, okay, to any of that stuff. What I do with those things, I've got about four or five of my favorite things, by the way. I mentioned before, many times I'm more inspired than I am a lot of other times. So when I'm in that state, if I can grab any anchor from that thing and throw it somewhere else. So what I do with those is I close my eyes and drop them randomly in my tickler file. Because when they land ad hoc in your in-basket, then I pick them up and read them and pay attention to them. I'm not gone numb to them. And they re-inspire. So anything like that, that's another, you know, a lot of the power of these sort of iterating systems like that are really cool. If you had a digital version of that, in terms of that checklist, one of the things you could do is you could just keep it somewhere in your computer or wherever you wanted to, and then just make a regular recurring reminder as a day-specific event on your calendar that says weekly review. At some point, you want to make the weekly review, you'd feel uncomfortable if you didn't do it. So you don't need a reminder, you can't stand not doing it. Because, you know, it'll get you back to squeaky clean. But until you get to that point, you're going to need all the help you can get to sort of build in the triggers to keep it going until you get used to what that feels like in that way.
I think what David said at the beginning really sums it up so nicely. If you want your practice to stay alive, reviewing regularly is really the critical success factor. Like we mentioned at the beginning, this content is just a preview of the type of content you can find on GTD Connect and our online store. And you can get to both of those destinations by heading to gettingthingsdone.com. Well, that's going to do it for this episode. But until next time, I'm Andrew J. Mason, asking you, what's your next action?